Welcome, and congratulations. I'm delighted that you could make it. Getting here wasn't easy, I know. And in fact, I suspect it was a little tougher than you realise. To begin with, for you to be here now, trillions of drifting atoms had somehow to assemble in an intricate and curiously obliging manner to create you. It's an arrangement so specialised and particular that it has never been tried before and will only exist this once. For the next many years, we hope, these tiny particles will uncomplainingly engage in all the billions of deft, cooperative efforts necessary to keep you intact and to let you experience the supremely agreeable but generally underappreciated state known as existence. Why atoms take this trouble is a bit of a puzzle. Being you is not a gratifying experience at the atomic level. For although devoted attention, your atoms don't actually care about you. Indeed, they don't even know that you are there. They don't even know that they are there. They are mindless particles, after all, and not in themselves alive. It is a slightly arresting notion that if you were to pick yourself apart with tweezers, one atom at a time, you would produce a mound of fine atomic dust, none of which had ever been alive, but all of which was once you. Yet somehow, over a period of your existence, they will answer to a single rigid impulse: to keep you, you. The bad news is that atoms are fickle, and their time of devotion is fleeting, fleeting indeed. Even a long human life adds up to only around 650,000 hours. And when that modest milestone flashes into view, or at some other point thereabouts, for reasons unknown, your atoms will close you down, then silently disassemble and go off to be other things, and that is it for you. Still, you may rejoice that it happens at all. Generally speaking, in the universe, it doesn't, so far as we can tell. This is decidedly odd because the atoms that so liberally and congenially flock together to form living things on Earth are exactly the same atoms that decline to do it elsewhere. Whatever else it may be, at the level of chemistry, life is fantastically mundane. Carbon, hydrogen, oxygen and nitrogen, a little calcium, a dash of sulfur, a light dusting of other very ordinary elements, nothing you wouldn't find in any ordinary pharmacy, and that is all you need. The only special thing about the atoms that make you is that they make you. That is, of course, the miracle of life. Whether or not atoms make life in other corners of the universe, they make plenty else. Indeed, they make everything else. Without them, there would be no water or air, or rocks, no stars and planets, no distant gassy clouds or swirling nebula, or any of the other things that make the universe so agreeably material. Atoms are so numerous and so necessary that we easily overlook that they needn't actually exist at all. There is no law that requires the universe to fill itself with small particles of matter, or produce life and gravity and the other properties of which our existence hinges. There needn't actually be a universe at all. For a very long time, there wasn't. There was no atoms and no universe for them to float about in. There was nothing, nothing at all, anywhere. So thank goodness for atoms. But the fact that you have atoms and that they assemble in such a willing manner is only part of what got you here. To be here now, alive, in the 21st century, and smart enough to know it, you also had to be the beneficiary of an extraordinary string of biological good fortune. Survival on Earth is a surprisingly tricky business. Of the billions and billions of species of living things that have existed since the dawn of time, most, 99.9% it has been suggested, are no longer around. Life on Earth, you see, is not only brief, but dismayingly tenuous. It is a curious feature of our existence that we come from a planet that is very good at promoting life, but even better at extinguishing it. The average species on Earth lasts for only about 4 million years, so if you wish to be around for billions of years, you must be as fickle as the atoms that made you. You must be prepared to change everything about yourself: shape, size, colour, species affiliation, everything, and to do so repeatedly. That's much easier said than done, because the process of change is random. To get from protoplasmal, primordial atomic gloop, to sentient upright human has required you to mutate new traits over and over in a precisely timely manner for an exceedingly long while. So at various periods over the last 3.8 billion years, you have abhorred oxygen, and then doted on it, grown fins and limbs, and jaunty sails, laid eggs, flicked the air with a forked tongue, been sleek, been furry, Lived underground, lived in trees, been as big as a deer and as small as a mouse, and a million things more. The tiniest deviation from any of these evolutionary imperatives, and you might now be licking algae from cave walls, or lolling walrus-like on the stony shore, or disgorging earth through a blowhole in the top of your head before diving 60 feet for a mouthful of delicious sandworms. Not only have you been lucky enough to be attached since time immemorial to a favoured evolutionary line, but you also have been extremely, make that miraculously fortunate in your personal ancestry. Consider the fact that for 3.8 billion years, a period of time older than the Earth's mountains and rivers and oceans, every one of your forebearers on both sides have been attractive enough to find a mate, healthy enough to reproduce, and sufficiently blessed by fate and circumstance to live long enough to do so. Not one of your pertinent ancestors was squashed, devoured, drowned, starved, stuck fast, untimely wounded, or otherwise deflected from its life's quest of delivering a tiny charge of genetic material to the right partner at the right moment to perpetuate the only possible sequence of hereditary combinations that could result, eventually, astoundingly, and all too briefly, in you.